LCS preview show. We make your fantasies come true, break down the best start in European history, and Loco Doco gets his bowl cut live. Don't touch that browser. The LCS preview show starts right now.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen.
What's up, everybody? Welcome to the LCS preview show. I am Rivington Bizen III, and after seeing what we have in store for Loco Doco today, I'm glad I never made a bet with Skara.
Yeah, those are some wise words, Riv. I'm Joshua Jett-Leisman, actually, and I predicted Altec and Selvr to start in your fantasy leagues last week, and it worked out. Today, I'll have a couple more sleepers that'll help you win your matchup.
All right, let's get this hype train rolling down the tracks with some exciting news. Yesterday, Riot announced more details about the 2014 World Championship. This year, there will be 16 teams competing as both Korea and China get a third entry in the tournament, with the wild card expanding as well.
Yeah, those 16 teams will then be divided into four groups, with the top two teams from each group advancing to the quarterfinals.
Now, yesterday, we also learned that the group stages will take place in Taipei and Singapore, with the quarterfinals kicking off in Busan, Korea.
Yeah, and after the quarterfinals, the World Championship will head to Seoul for the semis, with the 2014 champions being crowned on Sunday, October 19th, in the Sangam Stadium, home of the 2002 World Cup and soon to be the 2014 League of Legends Championship Finals.
That is true. And for the LCS teams that hope to compete in the 2014 World Championship, they now have a goal, is to finish in the top three of the regional playoffs. But first, they have to qualify. And last week, Alliance took another big step towards securing their spot in the European regionals. But first up, the 5-5 Super Hot Crew took on the 2-8 Copenhagen Wolves.
Yeah, and this was a very close game. It was also Mimer's chance to really shine in this game. Copenhagen Wolves always put up a good fight despite being at the bottom of the standings.
And they put up a pretty good fight here as they catch out Impaler. Super Hot Crew lose this one a 3-2 as Copenhagen Wolves just started off pretty early in this one. 16 minutes, nice place to grab a triple.
Yeah, and this was some more big time fighting. Now these fights went on for quite some time because these teams were very close. You can see 7-7. Copenhagen Wolves actually up 3,000 gold before this fight, but they did not account for Mimer's late game Kale.
No, Kale has been on the ban list quite a bit lately, and there's a reason. The double kill and just waiting to secure the final and last triple kill just made him that much bigger throughout the game, yeah. And they were able to carry this one on to the win. Next game, we're gonna be looking at Millennium battling it out versus Rockhat, going 6-4 versus a 3-7 here.
Yeah, what a strange season Rockhat has been having. They were in the bottom of the standings, and now they're kind of starting to look better. However, they get first blood in this game.
Yeah, and giving overpower first blood is not the way to go. However, 21 minutes in, Millennium gets caught out again. They take down Lucian. Cretan not having a good day.
Getting a little bit kicked around. A big fight at Dragon here. Rockhat up 3,000 gold and just trying to make something big happen.
And a great teleport in from Zazzus on this one to really throw the Dragon fight in favor of Rockhat. This really helped him secure the victory over Millennium.
Yeah, Millennium got the Dragon, but then lost pretty much everything else. Cretan just continually getting stunned by that Braum passive. Gets the triple kill for Corgi.
Gives Rockhat the win, and this time on our next highlight, Millennium are back at it against the struggling Fnatic. Fnatic 6-5, so is Millennium.
Yeah, what is going on with these two teams? Peke wants to pick the Syndra into the LeBlanc. Early on, it works out pretty well.
Yeah, they give Fnatic an early lead with this one. A little help from Yellowstar never hurts. Those supports getting a little bit of Roma.
A lot of attacks for that kill, surprisingly. Peke just kind of loosen up for this mid game.
Then at 16 minutes, Fnatic try the old Fnatic Bush play. But this one backfires on him a bit.
Yeah, Cotnex was invisible, and that, in fact, turned the tides here on Fnatic. The counter gank from Eve really got Cretan going, which turned the tides in this game. And the dives from Millennium. Their team had so much initiation.
Usually it's Fnatic going in for the dives, but Millennium was in the driver's seat this game. Those kills were just too much for Fnatic to handle.
Yeah, hugs all around right there. Kevin making the move to Millennium, but now finally getting some rewards.
To close things out in London, the first place Alliance actually had a tough time against the last place Wolves here. We actually see Youngbot going early on Aurelia.
You would think that Alliance would know what to do against Aurelia, because it's all Wicked has pretty much ever played, but Youngbot was actually the one taking Alliance to school in this game.
Then at 32 minutes, the crazy fight leads to a Copenhagen Wolves ace. Now, it doesn't look like it at first.
Yeah, how did Youngbot stay alive?
Wait it
out. Flashing as the Morgana ult was about to hit him, barely missing the cocoon. And then it's like, all right, Alliance, they feel like they're safe. They forget about the teleports coming in from behind them. Airwalks and Unlimited are able to close in. This actually put Youngbot at 10 kills 32 minutes into the game.
You could say he became a big buck by the end of this one. Definitely great play coming from him, but they could not keep tabs down no matter how far ahead they were. 36 minutes, he started to pull Alliance back in the game.
Yeah, losing Twitch 1v1 for Lucian like that was not something the Wolves could recover from. And unfortunately for them, again, they have a close game, and again, they fall as the losers.
Yep, Alliance would outlast the Copenhagen Wolves and pick up that win, coming out huge. Tabs on the just up and up for that team.
Yeah.
But all of them coming out to play. Froggen when he needs to,
Tabs,
now the 80 carry as well.
Huge points in fantasy as well, and also hoping to pick up those wins.
That doesn't hurt. After 2 days in front of a raucous crowd at London's SSE Arena at Wembley, the European table sets up like this. Alliance continues to dominate the European League, and after their win over SK Gaming, they have a 2-game lead heading into today's matches. Now I'd like to welcome Trevor Quickshot Henry back to the show after his week in London. It looked like it was a great time in front of an amazing crowd, Trevor. They didn't let the fact that the United States has a better soccer team affect them at all.
Well, I think the people of Cologne might have something to say about your football team, Riv. Anyways, it was an amazing weekend in London. I think you're right. The atmosphere was incredible. The energy in the venue was immense. And I just hope you guys could feel it on stream wherever you're watching in the world.
It was absolutely felt. It felt like you were there. And speaking of incredible, Alliance asserted their dominance of the European League once again with another perfect week, including their second win over the summer against SK Gaming.
Yeah, now Alliance have surpassed even my expectations, and they're pulling away from their only real competition this summer, which is SK Gaming. Their 10-2 start is the best in European LCS history ever, but it did take a full split of mediocrity before Alliance was able to adjust and reach their current dominant form. Now, Alliance, in my mind, they play a very patient play style. When they have a lead, they don't finish as quickly as SK Gaming do, but they also put themselves in less risky positions in most of their games. There are exceptions, of course, like last week against the Wolves, where Youngbuck almost single-handedly picked them apart. Alliance, though, they didn't get ruffled under the pressure. They were able to bounce back and send the Wolfpack back to their kennels. I just think Alliance are finally earning that super team badge that was sewn into their jumpers when the squad was put together at the beginning of the year by Froggen.
All right, Quickshot, good to have you back on the show. Have a great week six. All right, now for a look at what the players are saying about the European League, I'd like to welcome Efya Shaxtrporta to the show. You have recovered from your road trip in London yet?
Well, I'm a bit tired, but I'm ready for the show.
All right, one team that's got to be feeling pretty good after this trip is Rockat. Their position in London was great, and just after a couple weeks ago, you were asking them whether they were going to make any roster changes after a rough start to the summer split. Now they're riding a 4-0 game win streak. First, what did you say to Rockat that has them playing so well?
Well, of course, I can't take any credit for their recent success, but I did talk to them. And when I spoke to Rockat after London, Overpow told me that after starting the season with a 1-7 record, they really needed to make sure to get wins to come back in the season. Now, as such, they played super safe and actually a bit scared, but they felt that that was the way they had to play to ensure victory. Selivar agreed with that and said that we were scared that we would screw up against like we did in our previous games in the season. But right now, the later it gets in the split and the more games we get in, and especially with Veggie, their coach, being back, we will only be improving. Now, when I spoke to some of the other teams about Rockat's recent success, I received mixed reviews. The Super Hot Crew's Mr. Raleigh told me that Rockat is a very weird team because last split, they were bad at laning and won, but now they win the laning phase and lose the games. Now, Mr. Raleigh also had quite a bit to say about Rockat's bottom lane, and I quote, Vander has some of the best support mechanics in the EULCS, but I think that Selivar is one of the weaker ADs. The Copenhagen Wolves' Youngbuck had some positive notes on Rockat. He says that they've shown great performances lately on many different champions and that they're becoming more diverse in their champion pool, which of course makes it harder for opponents to know what to expect. Finally, Millennium's top laner Kevin, who lost versus Rockat in London, says that he feels like the Polish squad has improved a lot recently, especially after week three, coincidentally the week their coach Veggie moved into the house.
All right, Shox, thank you very much again for getting the inside information from the players. Have a great week six over in Cologne. And now for the Super Hot Crew, they'll be heading into week six with a new full-time support. The crew announced yesterday that Yarrow will be taking over the support role for the remainder of the summer split. He has changed his name to Casing. The post went to say that it was a mutual breakup based on Webull Fahler's inability to commit enough time to the LCS. And speaking of week six, the European LCS will kick off immediately following this show with four big games. Up first, the Wolves try to take a bite out of Fnatic, followed by Alliance versus Millennium. The Super Hot Crew versus Gambit, and SK Gaming taking on Rockat. Then Friday, week six continues with four more matchups, kicking off with Rockat taking on Alliance and finishing up with Gambit battling the Copenhagen Wolves. And for all of those week six games, as well as the eight happening here in North America, the pros will be playing on the 4.10 patch. Let's send it over to Jat for a quick look at the changes that will have the biggest impact on the League Championship Series.
Yeah, and it's actually been a few patches since we've had one that will have as much impact on the league as this 4.10 patch. So let's actually take a look at what's changing. First off, obviously, is the Nidalee rework. She's not allowed in the LCS for quite a while until those changes take suit. So we're not having no more nuclear-tipped spears in this week. Another thing that was actually changed, though, was Skarner. And this wasn't classified as a full rework, so he is operational. He's going to have a new passive, more move speed, skill cooldowns, and a more deadly ultimate. So if teams have practiced him, and if they're doing more of a standard lane setup, we might be seeing him. And as far as nerfs go in the patch, the champ that actually got hit the hardest was probably the most popular Rash since we've had Splinter. Twitch has been picked or banned in 81% of the LCS games. So the nerfs to his base damage, passive, and stealth aren't too surprising, but the big question will be, with the itemization changes, will those nerfs actually matter? And it's going to be on the LCS teams to try and test those theories. But let's take a more in-depth look at the AD carry builds. Now, the previous 4.9 patch, these were kind of the cost breakpoints of an unstacked Bloodthirster, a stacked Bloodthirster, and then the items you would generally build afterwards. Notice it was a very low price point for just the Zerker Greaves, the Bloodthirster, and the Doran's Blade to have 108 AD, bunch of AS, some good lifesteal, and that was when AD carries kind of turned on and became powerful. Those breakpoints change in this patch, and it's going to depend on which build people decide to go with about when they become powerful. So the first build that we're going to look at is, what about the exact same build? What if you still wanted to do Bloodthirster? What would you have? When you buy it, it's more expensive now, 4,940 gold, but before you stack it up, it's actually a better item. So you have the shield, you have more lifesteal, you have more AD, but obviously a fully stacked Bloodthirster would have been better previously. When you start adding it to other items, the thing I want to highlight is actually the Trinity Force build, because the amount of survivability you now get out of this, when if you factor in a level 18 AD carry with a potential 440 health shield from the Bloodthirster, they're actually a really hard person to kill who's still putting out substantial damage. So while it's a fairly nerfed build early on, it's not completely dead. But what are the things that we're probably going to see a bit more of? I think the most common build is going to be people jumping back to Blade of the Ruined King, and particularly with the buffs to Ghostblade now lasting 6 seconds of move speed on ranged champions, we're going to see this build. It happens at 7,340 gold when they get really powerful, but the Blade of the Ruined King is the old price point for Bloodthirster of becoming strong, which is what people are kind of attached to, and I think we're going to be seeing a lot more of that. So that could be a Twitch item. It could be a Lucian item even. This could be a Lucian build, or maybe even Vayne if people are picking it against more short-ranged compositions. And obviously, Kog'Maw could still do his Blade of the Ruined King Triforce build. We could be seeing a lot of him. This is most likely the builds people go for in the next patch. But there's also the slow ramping build. What if you just want to abuse the fact that Doran's Blade now has lifesteal, try and stall in the lane, build an Infinity Edge, and initially transition into a Phantom Dancer? If you can make it to this 8,480 gold build, you are the strongest AD carry in the game at that point. But you're weaker up until the point you get that, so it's going to be a big risk if people decide to do that. This could be a Caitlyn build, it could be a really well-protected Kog'Maw, it could be a Tristana if we ever see it coming back. But those are some of the potential. So if we kind of look at this big picture, you can see the old 4.9 builds were cheaper than the newer Bloodthirster builds, but there's the alternate builds that we could potentially be seeing a lot more of on the 4.10 patch. And we're going to see different things that all these teams decide to do. We'll see a lot of different stuff, I think, in Europe and the North American LCS. But aside from all these AD carry items, the thing that probably impacts them more than anything else is actually this guy, the Randwin's Omen. The fact that it no longer has a passive movement speed reduction when they get auto-attacked, and the fact that the attack speed reduction is less, makes almost every carry better in the late game. They can kite better, and they can deal more damage. There's not as many options to build to prevent AD carries from shredding you very, very well. But let's actually move on from the new reality of 4.10 patch to the LCS fantasy, and then actually take a look at the players who came up big last week, starting with our LCS sleepers for week five, Altec and Celeber. Altec, 38.8 points, another solid week. And if you're in an eight-team league looking for a reliable 80 carry starter, it could definitely be Altec. Celeber also delivered on some favorable matchups. He scored 52 points if you round up a little bit. Tabs as well had 61.7 points, which is the most of any player in the LCS last week. And I'm actually happy to say that we had our first correct fantasy pick here on the LCS preview show. Congratulations to @RichDite on your proper prediction. I'm pretty impressed. Tabs is not an easy guy to predict as the highest score. Now, if you think you can match Rich Dite's prediction skills, hit us up at LOL Esports. Use the hashtag LCS preview. Let us know who you think will be the studliest pro for week 6 of the LCS. And I'm talking about fantasy points. Sadly, it's time to check out the dudliest pros from week 5. And once again, it was Crumbs. He makes the list of the duds fairly often. And he said he plays like a support in the jungle. And after 2 straight weeks of dramatically underperforming, looks like he might be scoring like a support in the jungle too, which isn't any good. Our second dud is Shifter. Not only is he no longer carrying Dig, he's no longer carrying fantasy teams either. And another guy whose numbers have been consistently lower than expected is Bjergsen. He was started in 93% of leagues last week, the 4th highest for any player. I think it's fair to say 92% or so of the fantasy owners wish they would have started someone else. But let's put the past behind us, because now it's time for this week's sleepers. And with all of the 4.10 patch changes we talked about, here are a few AD carries that you might want to swap into the flex position. First, it's Genja. I know, I didn't think I'd recommend someone from Gambit either, but the last time Gambit faced the Wolves, Genja went 11-1-5. And he outfarmed Mr. Rouse by 30 CS in that game as well. Robert X. Lee is another guy you actually got to look at. They've actually already beaten Curse and Cloud9 this summer, and Robert X. Lee was the reason why. He went a combined 15-2-10 the first time those teams met, and you're hoping for a repeat performance. Our final sleeper, of course, is Kopp. Even though Curse lost to Complexity in the first meeting, Kopp still had good numbers. He went 3-0-7, and then he did even better when they last played EG, Curse's other opponent this week. In the first meeting, he went 6-0-8. But I also want to highlight a few of the players you might want to think twice about starting, maybe put on your bench. Crumbs, we said it again, and we have to say it again. His numbers have been crumbling, and this week Dignitas plays LMQ and COG, so it's not going to get any easier. Then there's the week 5 MVP of Overpow. Rocket is on a 4-game winning streak, and Overpow looked great last week, but this week he's playing SK and Alliance, and those teams just don't die. The last time Overpow faced these two teams, he went a combined 1-3-3 under Pow. Finally, a heads up for those of you that missed the beginning of the show. Casing, formerly Yarrow, full-time starter now for Super Hawk Crew. So if you have We Will Failure, it is time to drop him right away because he will be giving you 0 points. But now that the Fantasy Leagues has given us plenty to talk about here in the preview show, the real players don't seem to need an excuse to talk, yell, and sing a lot. Once again, we've captured the best for this week's edition of Ball Chat.
Shoot, if you win, you get 2 steaks.
I'm pretty sure I can buy 2 steaks anyway.
Wanna play some ARAMs?
Do it.
But.
Go now!
Yeah, keep going.
Good job!
Morgana, first pick. Erect out.
There is more Alliance fans here than there is SK fans.
Pro again.
I might as well be in a boy band.
Who's gonna tank?
I don't know.
No, we can't.
Look, okay. There's a trap.
Oh.
You can't roll the trap.
I fucking got it, dude. What the fuck?
We can nest with this.
LCS small plays.
They have no Jinx ult too, it's pretty big. Yep.
Just give it up then. I got it.
Oh my god.
Okay, you're a fucking god. Is anyone super low?
No.
I have ulties though. Lucian flash, so time that flash. Nice.
Holy shit.
Ball cut!
Niff, stop bullying us.
Yeah.
Bullying.
Yeah.
Stop making us think we're weird, Niff.
Prima donna girl.
Yeah.
All I ever wanted was the world.
On three, we're gonna sing happy birthday to Helios.
Okay.
On three, 1, 2, 3.
Happy birthday to you.
Ice ball.
I'm grabbing the wave.
Give me kill.
Okay.
You get.
Nice.
Top tower.
Give me shifter.
No, stay on shifter.
I'm on shifter.
Come next.
Kill them all.
Nice.
Go.
Oh.
Nice.
Good job, man.
You know what, Kwa? Someone's always going to be ahead.
Someone's always going to have your number.
It just so happens that it's your enemy every time.
Yeah.
Oh my god.
I want to retire.
He's got a point. Someone's always going to be ahead.
Yeah, it's true. But is it your enemy? Cop's kind of a mean dude right there.
That was a mean dude.
Yeah. All right, last week the North American LCS did something it hasn't done in a long, long time. They played a regular season game on Thursday. I was having flashbacks to 2013 all week long. But for those of you that missed week five of the NALCS, here's your flashback. Starting with Curse taking on Cloud9. 3-7 Curse, 6-4 Cloud9, if you believe it.
Yeah, Cloud9 trying to come back this season. They do not want to give up another loss. Coming into this week, they had four losses, which was the most they've ever had in a split. Good team fighting in this game against Curse after a pretty shaky opening.
Yeah, up 5-3 at the start of this one, but they're able to come out with a few more kills. This 26-minute fight just showed that Curse wasn't that superior in the fight phase here.
Big thing about this is Quas got the Luluwalt. He was huge, but he went in all alone, and the gold cards plus the Renekton stuns and all the control of Cloud9 just shut him down and made him ineffective.
C9 taking the win on that one. Up next, we have Team Solo Mid battling it out with Dig in the battle for a bowl cut on the line.
Yeah, this is the bowl cut game that will live in infamy. And this time, TSM thought maybe they were turning around until the shockwave.
That shockwave turns everything around with the rocket coming in from Cutie Pie. He had a few nice rockets last week.
Yeah, his Jinx play is pretty solid. Shifter looked great on Orianna there as well.
All these mix-ups and matchups coming in. LMQ versus CLG, 7-3s matchup head-to-head.
Yeah, first time these guys played, it was crazy with LMQ stopping a Baron. This game was pretty crazy as well. Great counter gank in the mid lane here from CLG. Double for Nafra coming out of nowhere.
A little misplay by LMQ as they go a little too hard on that, giving CLG enough to take the victory. That's usually all they need. Next up, the two last place teams faced off when EG took on Complexity.
Yeah, and honestly, this one was about Altec. They have this duel in the bottom lane where it seemed like Altec was completely cut out of position. He gets hit by the hook.
Where'd he go?
The overaggression. Everyone just ignores the Morgana ulti. Altec stealths up, ambushes him, and they pick up that clean double kill.
And already from half health, taking out Robert X Lee on that. This really set EG up to take this game away from Complexity. And they were able to do it quickly.
Altec had double-digit kills in this game after that sweet opening.
But Complexity would not leave this week empty-handed. Dignitas versus Complexity, 8-3 versus 2-9. Seems a bit lopsided.
Yeah, day two of the NALCS is where things got a little bit weird because this is the team that just got crushed by EG. And now they're crushing the number one team in the LCS. What's actually happening?
You could call it parity jab, but look at the focus of Complexity coming in here. They made it look easy.
Really seemed like Dignitas was not prepared for this game. They got ran over by Complexity.
Next up, we're going to highlight the 6-5 TSM versus the 3-8 EG. And it was time to get kind of Wild Turtle back on the game.
Yeah, he picked the Corki super early, was 2-0-3 coming into this fight, and then just runs EG down. EG could never reach Wild Turtle. Notice how he's taking almost no damage. And then he uses his summoner spells and dashes aggressively to finish off kills. This is Wild Turtle back on his game.
Team Solomid all around really having great play, and it's allowing these types of situations to happen more and more for them.
Yeah, that was a fight where Bjergsen died before even using his ultimate.
Yep. Moving in, Dyrus wanted more, but TSM gets the win. Nice and easy. CLG versus Curse, we're looking at next. 8-3 to 3-8, a little lopsided. We'll see what the deal is.
Yeah, surely we thought one of these NA teams was going to go 2-0 last week until Doublelift gets flayed into the Oswald wall. What a turn by Curse.
A really super close game until 27 minutes. That hook from Xspecial, such and so nice on the Doublelift.
Yeah, Curse, really a landmark moment for them where they came back after making a mistake.
And there's, we looked at LMQ versus C9, two teams that are 7-4. Like we said, every team went 1-1 this week. It was crazy back and forth.
And this is the strangest game because Cloud9 just got a quadra kill on Kasten and Baron into this fight where they get completely wrecked because they ran in without their ultimates.
Despite having that Baron Jet, like you said, a 4-for-1 LMQ would march down the mid lane for the win, and they just seem to be able to pick themselves back up off of any type of loss, off of any type of trouble.
What a strange, strange week and season we've been having. LMQ moving back into a tie for first place after that win.
It's going to be really a headhunt at the top of those standings. And now that 5 weeks of the NALCS games are sitting in our match history, let's take a look at where the teams stand now. There's a three-way tie in first place with Counter Logic Gaming, LMQ, and Team Dignitas, all winning two-thirds of their games so far this summer.
After that is a tie for fourth between Cloud9 and Team Solomid with Curse, Evil Geniuses, and Complexity rounding out these standings.
All right, and now we have the pleasure of welcoming Team Solomid's coach and Loco Doco back to the show, as well as Bjergsen, the TSM player that won the right to cut his coach's hair during last night's 1v1 tournament, if you were watching it, and Josie, who's here to help make Bjergsen's cut a little easier. How's it
going,
gentlemen?
Make it a little bit smoother.
Not good.
Not good?
Loco might not doing so well. I think we have a little bit different agendas here today.
Did you actually have anybody at the house that you wanted to win for the situation for a safer cut, or is Bjergsen the one to go?
I knew if Turtle won, I might lose a few ear tips or maybe eyebrows, so I'm glad Bjergsen won.
All right, guys. And now for those of you wondering why Loco's wearing a smock. Last week he came on the LCS preview show and announced a bet that he made with Dignitas' coach Scara. Check it out.
All right, I heard you have a bet with Scara about this match as well.
Oh yeah, the loser gets the bowl cut.
Dignitas to take the match and Loco Doco to take the bowl cut.
Bowl cut, bowl cut, bowl cut.
Bowl cut, bowl cut. I mean, you're all smiles back when you're making the bet.
That brings us to now. You've returned to the studio. I gotta say, we do commend you for coming back and actually holding your end of the bargain. We do know how much you love your hair, Loco Doco, but it's gonna be happening now.
Yeah, I mean, do you have any last words to your hairdo? I know you actually do keep very good care of your hair on most occasions.
I mean, I made a bet, I lost. What am I gonna do about it?
I think from now on, yeah, you can just ask Kiwi about some tips about his hair, so it'll be fine.
Yeah, bonding moment.
Yeah. All right, gentlemen, Bjergsen, go ahead. Let's get cutting.
All right. You want to put it on? All
right. Got a nice Dignitas pole.
Thank you, Josie. Just,
all right. Don't go too short.
A little more. Never mind.
We can always.
Have you done this
hair
before?
Hair grows.
Maybe like once or twice. God.
Oh, man.
Straight across the front. Make it look good.
All right.
There you go. Get aggressive, like level one. Right inside. There it is. There's a flash ignite. Right. That's what we're looking
for. It's actually pretty good first cut. It's a little short, maybe.
It's nice. What do you think, Josie?
I think
you got a nod from the terrace.
He's looking pretty good.
Absolutely.
Looking pretty good.
All right. Beautiful job. Now, while Loco gets his locks cut, we've got to talk about something that happened for the first time in league championship history.
Yeah.
Every North American LCS team went 1-1. Last week, last place Complexity upset first place Dignitas. The Evil Geniuses took out Complexity, but got beat by Team Solo Mid, who then lost to Dignitas and earned Loco his new haircut. The same goes for the other four teams, with CLG beating LMQ, who beat Cloud9, who beat Curse, who beat Counter Logic Gaming. And while last week was a historical first, it does make the argument that there is more parity in the NALCS than ever before.
Yeah, last week didn't seem to make too much logical sense. There's a few reasons why we're seeing more parity in the NALCS and why we had our first 1-1 week in history. First, we're seeing a lot more inconsistency from the top teams, particularly Cloud9. Coming into the summer, they had dominated the first two splits. They'd only lost 7 LCS games over the last year, including the playoffs. They've already lost 5 this summer, Riv. You could say part of that is the improvement of top-tier teams like Dignitas, COG, TSM, and the emergence of LMQ. But those squads only equate for 3 of the 5 losses Cloud9 suffered. The other 2 are at the hands of Complexity and EG. Another reason of the parity is the entry of the aforementioned LMQ. You know, even though they've had their share of ups and downs, LMQ's tied for first place. And when you add a team in first place, in place of a team like Coast, who is consistently in the bottom 3 of the standings, the league just gets tougher overall. But it's not just the team and the talent that's improved, it's kind of the preparation as well. Last year, during the summer split, only 3 teams had an analyst. This year, all 8 teams have people helping them out as a coach or an analyst. And we've talked about it before. Game prep isn't just about picks and bans. It's more about coming up with level 1 strategies. It's about developing methods to squeeze out every extra bit of experience while simultaneously starving your opponent. And not only are the number of coaches increasing, the quality is as well.
Right.
You know, even the coaches that were coaching previously are better at it now, and they're more experienced. So the addition of analysts have allowed teams to take their games to the next level, and it's paying off with more competitive games, which is better for the league and the fans.
Absolutely. Now, coming up this weekend, we have 8 more highly competitive North American games, so don't worry. Up first, it's Team Solo Mid. They're taking on Counter Logic Gaming, then Complexity looks to make it 2 in a row against the 2-time NA champs, Cloud9.
Yeah, then on Sunday, our coverage begins with Cloud9 taking on the Geniuses, with Curse and Complexity finishing out week 6 and most likely scoring a lot of those fantasy points.
That's right. All right, it looks like the bowl cut is almost done, but first let's count down the biggest plays from week 5 in the League Championship Series, or as Loco Doco's hairstylist calls them, the Penta. All right, coming in at number 5, Yarrow with a massive tidal wave to catch all 5 Copenhagen Wolves.
More towards the front, he puts a cataclysm down, that's a good tidal wave coming in, and Mimer absolutely crapping on them from the back. We'll see the Destiny used. Are they going to be able to finish off? Count on, dodges a bit of damage, but it's 2 coming out now. Make that 3 for Mimer.
At number 4, The Great Escape starring LMQ's Vasilij.
It
happens
pick.
Right here, in and out, quick enough to get someone to die. Whoa, the lantern on the other side.
Yeah, CLG threw the kitchen sink at LMQ right there and still didn't come away with a kill. So Vasilij somehow makes it out.
And at number 3, Doublelift zaps a dragon.
We're rushing down this dragon. Heals from Quas, get Dominate back up to Half-Life, and Link not going to be there for this.
Oh my gosh!
lift as he fixes his glasses and goes ahead and backs off.
Oh, they don't have their
that's wrong
jungler. Okay. Just give it up then.
I got it.
Oh, what the fuck? My god. Okay, you're a fucking god.
Coming in at number two, Altec shows off some fancy footwork on Twitch.
Is doing quite a good job on Blue. They're hooked onto Altec, and he is so grab. Low.
What a great soul shackle as well. Pulled in for the rest of the damage. Robert X. Lee throws down the relentless pursuit. He should have the finisher.
Wow.
They trade it back and forth. This may have been a mistake. Crepo's now ready to go on this one. Altec turns for the last shot.
And your number one play this week comes from Insect. I mean, Airwax.
Hold on to this one. Wow. Airwax goes very deep, but he kicks his frogger. He gets the kick. Intervention used. And Youngbuck now the focus of that one.
But check this fight out. You can see it all starts off. Airwax goes very deep on this one. Had that Lee syndrome deep in there. Flashes across. Kicks frogger straight back in there.
Now, if you missed any of today's LCS preview show or simply need to watch it again, then head over to lolesports.com.
Yeah, there to the right of the leagues and to the left of tickets, you'll find our digital home with VODs of our past episodes and also this one.
And now it's time to reveal to the world Loco Doco's new haircut. Bjergsen. Ooh.
Wow. Actually, it's pretty good.
I think it suits.
Yeah.
It actually suits you. Yeah. You could rival the Kiwi.
Yeah. It is a little Kiwi kid-esque.
Yeah.
At least you have the coloration in it as well. So you got like two tiers of hair color.
Going. Yeah. So it brings out the bowl.
Absolutely.
Oh, God.
So is the team going to embrace this now?
Maybe. Loco was trying to get more people to get the bowl so he wouldn't feel as alone. But
the more I think about it, it's a little lopsided right now. So, I mean, we can always tie that up in the future.
We can always go shorter. Yeah.
Right? I can cut some more.
There you go. All right, everyone. That's all the time we have for today's show. Thanks for watching.